Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our second item of business this morning is consideration of a legislative consent memorandum on the Trade, Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership Bill. I welcome Tom Arthur, Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, and Alistair Hamilton, Procurement Policy Portfolio Manager with the Scottish Government. I invite the Minister to make a brief opening statement before I take any questions from members.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. The UK Bill makes provisions in three areas: public procurement, technical barriers to trade and intellectual property, where legislative intervention is needed to give effect to the terms of the UK's accession to the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. Public procurement is a devolved matter and the implementation of international agreements is devolved to the extent it relates to procurement. The Bill therefore triggers the consent process in respect of the procurement provisions which apply to Scotland. These are amendments to Scottish procurement regulations which are minor and technical in nature, relating to contracts awarded under international rules and contract award notices. In contrast to the Trade Australia-New Zealand Act, which conferred delegated powers on UK ministers for the purpose of implementing the procurement chapters of those trade agreements and to which the Scottish Parliament withheld its consent, in this bill the UK Government has agreed to make necessary provision to amend the Scottish regulations on the face of this bill. We welcome this change of approach, which affords this Parliament the proper ability to scrutinise these proposals. We recommend that consent is given to this bill. My officials will continue to work with the UK Government officials to agree a pragmatic approach to preparations for commencement of those provisions of this bill that relate to Scotland.
Thank you, Minister. I'll take questions from members. Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I should remind members of my register of interests and my connection with the Scotch Whisky Association. And on that tone, can I ask the Minister about how the Scottish Government views the opportunities from the CPTPP, specifically the opportunities for growing exports of Scotch whisky to what are very important and developing markets, and how the liberalisation of trade and the potential reduction in tariffs in countries like Malaysia, which are currently an important market for Scotch whisky but with very high tariffs, will benefit the Scottish economy?
Well, I think we would welcome the opportunities that this agreement will afford. I think the analysis that has been provided suggests that overall the impact will be in the UK economic growth over the next couple of decades will be relatively minor, but any opportunities that are afforded for a key Scottish industry such as Scotch whisky are of course welcomed, and I'm conscious that my colleagues, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and the Minister for Trade, have written to the committees stating out in some detail the work that they have undertaken in terms of engagement with the UK Government on the broader policy intent of the agreement.
Thank you.
The Minister referred to correspondence we've had from Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs. He has raised some concerns that there would be potential for competition from producers in countries with lower animal welfare standards. I don't know if the Minister this morning is able to speak to that. I do appreciate it was the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs who contacted about that issue. But if the Scottish Government is going to monitor the impact of the agreement on Scottish producers, if this is still an area of concern.
Continue to seek to engage constructively with the UK Government on the implementation of this agreement, and of course to continue to engage with our stakeholders. I'm sure the Convener will appreciate it as my colleague, Cabinet Secretary, who leads on these particular matters.
Maggie Chapp.
Thank you very much, Minister, for that. I just have a question. I know you said that this the relationship or the interest of Scotland is mainly around procurement, but I'm just curious to know whether you've had any discussions with the UK Government about the ISDS provisions in this bill, because the UK Government has already agreed to exclude ISDS clauses in any future trade agreement with Canada, and I'm just wondering whether you've had those discussions and received any such assurances on this too.
With regards to the position in terms of the engagement that the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government, I think that's broadly set out in the correspondence that I referred to earlier. clearly the matters before us today in terms of what have triggered legislative consent are fairly narrow and technical and relate to the devolved aspects of procurement.
But do you not see that there's a potential impact for some of the broader policy work that we're trying to achieve in Scotland if ISDS clauses remain in place and foreign investors can actually then sue the Scottish Government for certain policy proposals? It's enacting.
I recognise there will be a range of views on the provisions within any trade agreements that the UK enters into. What I would recognise is that well, this Parliament will have its opportunities and takes opportunity to express its views in these matters. Ultimately, decisions whether or not to enter into these agreements is a matter for the UK Government. We obviously appreciate the opportunities that we are afforded for engagement. We would obviously want to strengthen these opportunities for engagement with the UK Government. But with regards to the matter before us this morning, I'm speaking to is the relatively narrow and technical aspects of the implementation through the Act and how that triggers legislative consent with regards to procurement.
I understand that, but I suppose it can be seen as broader support for issues that could actually trip the Scottish Government up in future, but I appreciate that. I'm not going to get anywhere further on this.
Thank you. Colin Beattie, did you?
Yeah, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands also raised a concern about the lack of a formal role for the Scottish Parliament in respect to scrutinising the free trade agreements generally. And international relations, of course, are reserved in practice. These agreements do impact on the competence of devolved administrations in a number of areas. How would the Scottish Government like to see any future agreements progressed to improve scrutiny?
I'm conscious that this is going beyond my remit on public procurement, and I recognise that when the committee has last considered LCMs with regards to the ratification of trade agreements, its concern has been primarily with the contents of the LCM. The Scottish Government's position is well understood, both in terms of its constitutional aspirations and also our policy position as set out in the Vision for Trade paper published at the start of 2021. So our views are clearly set out. With regards to how things operate at the moment, what we would always seek to do is to have the maximum possible engagement with the UK Government to ensure that Scottish interests are represented, and the endeavours to that effect have been set out in the letter and the correspondence that the committee has received that I referred to earlier.
It's just a technical question about the LCM. So the Scottish Government are saying that, you know, they're very minor. They do amount to material divergence from EU law, however, they're very minor, and recommends consent to the LCM. One of the regulations does involve that way in which a contract is advertised. So currently there's an option to include the value of successful tender or values of highest and lowest tenders to comply with the membership. The option to include the highest and lower tenders instead of the actual contract value will be removed. Does that have any impact, or is there any significance to that change?
These, of course, are minor changes that we are required to make, given the requirement to implement this particular agreement. With, in terms of some of the more detail on it, any specifics, I'm going to ask Alistair if he wants to comment.
Yeah, so this relates to when a contract has been awarded. This isn't the advertising of a contract competition. So once a contract has been awarded, an authority must publish what's known as a contract award notice. Currently, our regulations, which transpose the EU directives, allow for either that notice to contain the actual value of the contract awarded or the highest and lowest tenders received. That is a choice at the moment that authorities have. The CPTPP quite simply doesn't allow that choice. It requires that only the actual value is awarded, and that's a reflection as much of anything as the fact that it is an agreement which has evolved in a different space with different members. We don't anticipate any significant impact for authorities from this.
To do neither of the figures, that's...
It just removes that choice. So.
Okay. Okay, so any other questions from members? Nope, that brings us to the end of the session. Thank you to the Minister for attending this morning. So I'll briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Our next item of business is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's 2024-25 budget. The budget was published on the 19th December 2023. The Committee's Chamber debate on the budget is taking place tomorrow. I welcome Neil Gray, Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, Fair Work and Energy, who is joined by Colin Cook, Director of Economic Development, Aidan Griswood, Director of Economic Strategy, and Cathy Johnson, Deputy Director, Economic Analysis and Head of Economist Profession, Scottish Government. As always, members and witnesses should keep questions and answers as concise as possible, and I invite Neil Gray to make an opening statement.
Good morning, Convener, colleagues. Thank you very much for inviting me this morning. Welcome the opportunity to be here to discuss the Wellbeing Economy, Fair Work and Energy portfolio spending plan set out in the budget for 2024-25. You will have heard the Deputy First Minister speak about the challenging context for the recent budget, as well as the many opportunities that lie ahead. The budget underlines our commitment to progressing the First Minister's three missions of equality, opportunity and community. Our focus on delivering a fair, green and growing economy is underpinned by investment in this portfolio and wider investment across government of £5 billion that will make an economic difference. We are committed to green growth. We will scale up renewable energy with investment of £67 million as part of our commitment to provide up to £500 million to anchor a new offshore wind supply chain in Scotland, and combined with the funding from for the enterprise agencies and the Scottish National Investment Bank, the total support for offshore wind in Scotland for 24-25 is £87 million. This investment will stimulate and support private investment critical to the growth of the sector. This is one of the greatest areas for us to achieve growth, transform our economy and leverage private capital, as was identified by the First Minister's investor panel. And to help realise that, we will this year set out a green industrial strategy to ensure we seize the economic opportunities of the transition to net zero. The budget is focused on funding that will have the biggest economic impact possible. It will increase investment in digital connectivity by more than 50%, and we will expand our tech scaler programme, progress the implementation of the National Innovation Strategy, and begin delivery of the Pathways Report to diversify and encourage more entrepreneurship, particularly to see more women start and scale their own business. Our tech scaler and digital rollout programmes are examples of our strong progress in delivering our National Strategy for Economic Transformation ambitions. I wrote to you last week advising that the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is being refreshed, so it remains fit for purpose in a changing landscape and is focused on delivering as fast as possible in the areas we have competitive advantage in. We continue to support business, including by freezing the basic property rate, delivering the lowest such rate in the UK for the sixth year in a row, and providing a package of reliefs worth an estimated £685 million. The Small Business Bonus Scheme remains and is the most generous of its kind in the UK, in all taking an estimated 100,000 business properties out of rates altogether, and across all elements, 95% of businesses in Scotland are estimated to be paying lower rates than anywhere else in the UK. So our missions and values are the guiding principles of this budget, and this is clear through the actions we are taking to promote a fair economy, including recognising the critical role employability has in achieving the First Minister's three missions. And I believe that despite the challenging fiscal context we are faced with, we have developed a package that will help to deliver a fair, green and growing wellbeing economy. I thank you and look forward to the discussion that we'll have before us.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. While you've outlined areas of investment and spoken about energy policy, the Wellbeing Economy and Fair Work budget has seen a reduction of 8% in real terms compared to last year. The committee has recognised the difficult financial decisions the government are having to make, but within this portfolio we are seeing a reduction. And when we look at what the Scottish Fiscal Committee, Scottish Fiscal Commission are looking at the longer term prospects for the Scottish economy, they are seeing still subdued long term GDP growth, a lack of productivity growth. We also have population challenges, and you know that comes from an ageing population. And how does an 8% cut to this budget align with ways in which we're trying to address those long-term challenges that Scotland are facing?
Thank you, Convener. So there are a few things that I would say in answer to that. First of all, in recognising what you have just said, we have been faced with a real terms cut to our budget. The block grant allocation is down, as is confirmed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And so we've had to take very challenging decisions. But we are focused, as I said in my introduction, on areas that we think we can generate the most economic activity and see the economic transformation, developing a green, growing well-being economy, and that's where the decisions that are relevant for my portfolio have been focused in on. In terms of our economic performance, I think the SFC's analysis is fair. Of course, we are tied to a UK economy that is underperforming, that has, when we compare ourselves to many of our European neighbours, we see lower GDP growth, lower productivity, lower fairness, lower rates of poverty in those countries. And my aspiration is for us to match those countries. The GDP figures out this morning show that for the last quarter that is available, quarter three for 2023, we had higher GDP growth than elsewhere in the UK, but I accept that that is still low growth. It's not the areas that we would want to see it in. We've also seen over the recent period that the Scottish productivity rate is growing but faster, admittedly still slow, but growing faster than the rest of the UK. We've got lower rates of unemployment. So on the areas that we can make a difference, we're investing to do so, and we're seeing results off the back of that. The problem we have is that we do not have the full levers of control over the wider economy, and we are tagged to a UK economy that is grossly underperforming.
Now, last week, you might be aware, we had the retail, hospitality and leisure industries in front of the committee, and an area where the government does have responsibility is business rates. And while they did raise concerns over other factors that we don't have responsibility for, such as energy costs, they are pretty robust in their criticism of the government in terms of the consequentials that came to us because of the 75% discount on business rates that is in the UK government. So £260 million came to the Scottish government through Barnett consequentials, but over those 2 years we haven't reduced any kind of similar or equivalent scheme. My understanding is that Wales has. It's not as generous as the UK scheme, but they have used some of the money to do that. Now, you might have heard the evidence last week. Some of the criticism was around lack of engagement from the government, a lack of the ability to have a discussion about those consequentials and what way they could be targeted to that sector. Because while you're right, we are seeing increased productivity and activity in some areas, that is a sector where the pressures on them is eating into the profits. So while you know, they're seen as a busy sector that's recovering from the pandemic, it is difficult for them to invest in their businesses or invest in skills because of the very extreme margins they're operating in. So I don't know if you want to respond to the comments last week around the business rates, why the government aren't looking at some kind of business relief for that sector that would bring them in line with the rest of the UK.
Thank you. Yes, I did see the evidence that came through, and I more than understand the challenge that the retail, hospitality and leisure sectors are facing, not least because myself, the Deputy First Minister and Tom Arthur met with industry representatives last week to discuss just that, and the Deputy First Minister set out that the challenge that was before us in this budget is if we passed on the rates relief consequentials that came from the UK government's decision, not only would it not fully cover, the consequentials would not fully cover a similar discount here in Scotland, but we would have had no further increased investment potential for our NHS or other elements of the public service. So there was a difficult decision taken, and the decision that was...
I accept that, but it's £260 million. In the scheme of the things for the NHS, that's not going to solve the challenges we're facing in the NHS. And I'm not arguing that we replicate the scheme at UK level, but to give some kind of relief to that sector, you know, as I said, Wales are going for a different model, and the Fraser-Valander are saying that the money, 260, is not enough to cover an equivalent scheme, but there seems to have been a lack of discussion or consideration for what can be done to provide some relief to that sector?
Well, no, we have provided relief and acknowledged the challenge that there is in our island communities and provided 100% relief to island community businesses in that sector, acknowledging the fact that there are challenges, and if we could have done something more, we would have. And the decision that we have taken is evidenced by the fact that in England there is a real terms cut to our NHS budget. I think at a time of challenge for our NHS recovering from the pandemic, I think it was the right decision that was taken. Now, that's not to say that we are not looking at all we can do, looking at other opportunities that might be available, and that was part of the reason for the meeting that myself, Tom Arthur, and the Deputy First Minister had with industry representatives last week. It was very constructive, and there are further engagements planned in order to look at what more we can do, both in the devolved and the reserved space, looking at ahead of the UK budget that might be able to provide relief to them and support to them, because I absolutely appreciate and was able to articulate to them that my understanding of the challenges that that industry is currently facing. And had we the finance available to look at alternative support arrangements, clearly that would have been something that we would have considered. But at this stage, the fiscal context was such that we weren't able to do it.
Now, before I bring Murdo Fraser in, it's just a comment that last year, with the budget, the committee raised similar concerns for that sector, for tourism and hospitality. And we did receive a similar response. At the point of the budget, there was no additional resource for that sector. But in, if there was any flexibilities in year, that would be a sector that would be considered for additional support. That didn't really materialise to any extent. Is there a, you know, can you give us some kind of clear indication today that you are hearing the concerns of that sector, and that, you know, if there was to be some flexibility, that is a sector that would be engaged in considering how they could be supported?
Yes. Last year's budget situation with continued inflation meant that there was ongoing inflation related pressures that meant that we had to make in-year savings. So the opportunity for further flexibility in-year was not possible. Of course, both through this budget process and going forward, of course, we would continue to consider industry representations, as we did last week, and we've committed to further engagement with the industry on that basis. Of course, the UK government hasn't committed to provide that relief beyond this year, so there is going to be a cliff-edge moment there, and it will be interesting to see what plans there are to provide continued support to the industry, which is what we're looking to do, provide long-term sustainable support, considering the option of long-term rates reform that would assist the sector, as opposed to one-off or you know, a support package that is only worth a couple of years.
Okay, thank you. Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning, officials. I want to follow up some of the lines of questioning from the convener. I want to start by asking you about the overall budget, because according to the SPICE briefing we have, the Scottish Government's budget for the coming year has increased in cash terms by 4.5% and in real terms by 2.8% over the previous year. Would you agree with those figures?
I thank Murdo Fraser for pointing out the difference that is made by our tax decisions in Scotland, tax decisions that, of course, Mr Fraser has opposed. Our block grant has been cut in real terms by the UK government, so we're having to take decisions in Scotland to try to ameliorate the impact that austerity has made. So our budget is up in real terms, but only because of the decisions that we have taken on tax.
So I'm glad we agree, Cabinet Secretary, your budget is up in real terms.
Because of the tax decisions that we have taken that Mr Fraser opposes.
2.8%. So in that context, therefore, with the budget overall up, this is about choices being made by the government. And as the Convener has pointed out in the portfolio that you cover in Cabinet, it has been cut 8.3% in real terms. So we see tourism down 12.3%. Scottish National Investment Bank down 29.2%, employability down 24.2%, enterprise trade and investment down 16.7%, all in real terms. That's overall cuts of £118 million in cash terms against a backdrop where the overall budget has increased. What does that tell us about the priority that the government gives to growing the economy?
As I said in my introduction, we're spending £5 billion across government to support the economy. The decisions that we have taken, unlike the UK government, are to prioritise public services. We cannot have a strong economy without a strong society. The two are mutually dependent. And so ensuring that we have strong public services at a time where our NHS is recovering from the pandemic, making sure that we have a healthy workforce that is available to our businesses and employers is incredibly important. We've looked to strike the balance between the difficult decisions of having to find savings in order to ensure that we are investing in public services, investing, giving a real terms increase into our NHS. But I recognise that this is a challenging time for our business community and for others, not just through this budget, but because of 13 and a half years of UK government austerity that has meant that the resilience in the economy, resilience in our public sector is much reduced. We are doing what we can to ensure that our public services and our wider economy is supported, which is why we're making the investments that we are in the likes of the Tech Scaler Network, which is why we are looking to implement the Pathways report from Mark Logan and Anna Stewart to see greater diversity in entrepreneurship, see more women start and scale their own businesses. It's why we're investing increased amounts in green energy to establish a supply chain rooted here in Scotland. We're making decisions that I hope will see the transformation and the further growth of our economy.
You just told me that the government's chosen to prioritise other areas and not the economy. In fact, the Spice briefing confirms that. There are eight portfolios where spending has increased. There are only three where it's been cut in real terms, including the one that you represent, economy, fair work and energy. Do you not think your job in Cabinet is to fight for the Scottish economy and to fight for a fair share of the cake? You're clearly not doing a very good job.
I thank Murdo Fraser for that personal slight. I have obviously been arguing in Cabinet and in the budget rounds, as I'm sure the Deputy First Minister would attest, for ensuring that we are investing in areas of priority that are going to see economic activity and economic growth, economic transformation. I believe we've achieved that. Of course, it's a challenging budget, but it is across the board. There is no area where I think we are finding an easy situation or a situation of plenty. And that, I say, comes back to the fact that we've endured 13 and a half years of UK government austerity. We've seen a real terms block grant cut to our budget this year, 1.2% down. And we're having to make difficult choices, including on taxation, in order to try to ameliorate that. But it shouldn't be for us in the Scottish Government to continue mitigating for the mistakes and the trouble that has been caused by UK government decisions. We should be looking to seize the opportunities that are available to us. Sadly, we do not have that luxury at this present time.
And yet your government is making the choice to deliberately cut the enterprise aspects of the budget and prioritise other areas, and that's a choice you are making. And it's having consequences. The convener referred to the evidence we had last week from the hospitality sector. There's a survey being published this morning by the Scottish Licensed Trade Association. I don't know if you've seen that, but in a survey of over 500 of their members, 96% of respondents feel the Scottish Government is out of touch with the business community. How's that new deal with business going?
So, the first point, Mr. Fraser raised the support that we give to enterprise agencies. Of course, enterprise agencies don't exist in other parts of the UK. We have an enterprise agency network here in Scotland because we value the support that we can give to our business community that is not available elsewhere in the UK. In the UK. Of course, I recognise and I'm sad about the survey from the Scottish Licensed Trade Association this morning. That's precisely why the First Minister made it an early priority of his to establish the New Deal for Business. That's going to take time to ensure that we rebuild that relationship with the business community. That has been one of my top priorities since coming into office, and it's not something that I take for granted. I will work work to regain and re-earn that trust over the time that I am in office, and ensure that the relationship between business and government is a strong one, where we give as early sight as possible on policy decisions, where we support the business community to have the best possible trading landscape within which to operate, which is why we've given the rates relief package that we have, and to ensure that their representations on area issues that matter to them are heard. Of course, we're not going to agree on everything. We are going to disagree. That's going to be the nature of business and government. But where there is disagreement, I want to at least ensure that the business community understand why we're taking the decisions that we are, and to continue to ensure that we are advocating for the business community as well, where there are areas that we can advocate on their behalf for the decisions that have been taken for us by the UK government.
Well, it doesn't sound like you're agreeing with the business community on very much, and they're not very impressed so far. Let me just ask you one more question about income tax divergence, because amongst the evidence we heard last week from the hospitality sector is that the impact of income tax divergence is that they are now having to pay higher salaries to attract people to Scotland, because tax rates here are higher than they are south of the border. And I've heard this many times from people in business, particularly from the finance sector, that they now struggle to encourage people to relocate to Scotland because of the tax differential. So what assessment have you done of the impact income tax differential will have on the long-term growth of the Scottish economy?
Now, obviously, that is something that we take into consideration whenever we take a decision on tax, and it's something that the Scottish Fiscal Commission assesses on likely behavioural changes, and we do everything we can to make sure that that is balanced. Of course, there is going to be the potential for behavioural change. However, I haven't seen evidence of that. There is anecdotal evidence, but there is no direct evidence. What it does allow us to do is ensure that we have an investment opportunity into our public services. The whole reason why the premise of Mr. Fraser's first question was possible around a larger budget being available to the Scottish Government was because of our tax decisions that we have taken. However, the discussions that I had last week with the hospitality industry pointed to much wider challenges on recruitment. They pointed directly to the impact that Brexit has had with the loss of access to labour, both people moving away and people not coming to work here in Scotland, and the stringent UK government immigration system, which is not supporting the needs of the Scottish economy. I'm willing to work with them. I gave that commitment to look at providing that evidence of how they are struggling to recruit internationally to make representation to the UK government ahead of its budget, and I'll continue to work with them to do so. But in terms of migration within the UK, of course, for every year of the last 20 years, there has been a net inward migration from the rest of the UK into Scotland. I'm not complacent about that, but it points to the fact that Scotland is indeed a very attractive place to live, work and to do business.
And yet net immigration into the UK is at record high levels, but Scotland does worse than every part of England, apart from the northwest, at attracting new immigrants to come and live and work here. So clearly there's an issue that needs to be addressed.
And I would point to the fact that it's a migration system that is working for one part of the UK, not for the whole of the UK. We need a much more flexible migration system that is tailored to the needs of the composite parts of the UK. Short of independence, I think that would be the right thing to do. It's possible in Canada. It's also been possible for us to have Scottish-only elements of the UK migration system, such as on the super sponsor scheme for Ukrainian displaced Ukrainians that I had previously had a responsibility for. It blows my mind, it beggars belief, that the UK government continues to have a one-size-fits-all migration system that means Scotland is not able to attract the people from around the world that we want to. And my appeal once again would be for the UK government to accept proposals such as the rural visa pilot that isn't just being proposed or supported by the Scottish Government, but has been supported by other parts of the UK as well, as a way of ensuring that we have a flexible migration system that responds to the economic needs of those communities, that we need to ensure we have suitable labour market access to ensure our public services and also our businesses are able to continue to thrive.
Well, perhaps immigrants are not coming here because they don't see the economic opportunities and they don't see a government that is prioritising the economy, as we've just seen from your budget.
Well,
I have no more questions.
I think that's belied by the fact that we have record levels of foreign direct investment, that we have a foreign direct investment rate that outstrips growth, that outstrips the rest of Ukraine, and outstrips the rest of Europe. And, as I repeat, every year for the last 20 years, Scotland has had net inward migration from the rest of the UK. So perhaps some of these people are arriving in other parts of the UK and then choosing to move to Scotland.
OK, we'll make some progress. Maggie Chapman, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for being here and thank you for what you've said so far. We heard just this morning at a briefing from the Scottish Fiscal Commission that when you were talking about income tax, that we've got, you know, over £700 million more to spend thanks to our income tax proposal. So Murdo Fraser might be interested in looking at what the Scottish Fiscal Commission says on that point specifically to invest in our public services. I want to focus, though, on employability and workforce development. And I note that in the SPICE briefing and in other documentation that we've received, we know that employability funding has fallen in the proposed budget. We're closing Fair Start Scotland to new referrals. There's been a reduction in the Fair Work and Labour Strategy line because of the closed Workplace Equality Fund, closing the Disability Public Social Partnership. These kinds of things. I wonder what assessments have you done on the impacts of these reductions, both in terms of economic outcomes and equalities outcomes?
I thank Maggie Chapman for those questions. It's true to say that our employability funding has had to reduce this year to £90 million. We're confident in working with our regional economic partnerships and our local employability partnerships that we can continue to see strong employability support provided that is person-centred, that is focused on ensuring that we continue to close the disability employment gap and do all that we can to work in a collaborative approach with third sector partners. I was able to see in Dundee, for example, evidence of a group of, I think it was eight different third sector partners that came together in Dundee to provide a employability service that was truly person-centred, because each of those third sector partners was representing a different interest group that would and specialist group for disability services, mental health support and other elements. I've been incredibly impressed by the work that has been done. I'm keen that we do all we can to continue to support that in a way that continues to be voluntary. We're seeing evidence, both anecdotal and clear evidence, that that is making a real difference, that the lack of not having a mandation and a sanctioning regime as part of the work that we do is making a discernible impact on people being willing to engage and engage for a longer period of time, and we're having strong results off the back of that engagement work as well. We'll continue to assess the impact that the positive and the potential negative impact that our spending decisions have in areas such as employability, and I would obviously be keen to ensure that the committee is furnished with further information as that those assessments are carried out.
Thank you for that offer of ongoing engagement on impacts of these decisions. I suppose if we're thinking about, as you started this morning, you know, the desire to have equality, opportunity and community at the heart of all government decisions, those missions or those challenges cut across portfolios. And I'm wondering whether how conversations in budget discussions that you've had with the Deputy First Minister and others, how those conversations have gone. Are you able to talk about the impacts on black and minority ethnic people of these employability cuts, for instance? So cutting across, and maybe I'm putting on my Equalities Committee hat here, but if we're thinking about equalities across the board and equality of opportunity, equality and fundamental equality as the missions state, how is it that we're actually tracking across the impact of decisions right now, never mind, you know, further down the line. What assessment have you done of those kinds of impacts on previous decisions, and how have they informed current decisions?
Yes, to answer Maggie Chapman's question directly, we had a discussion, I don't think it was in this committee room, but it was another committee room with Cabinet Secretaries and the Deputy First Minister, as Maggie Chapman would expect, looking at our Fairer Scotland duties and ensuring that the decisions we were taking were taking cognizance of those duties and were informed by them. So we had we had discussions in this area and other elements of the portfolio, considering our impact upon child poverty and other elements as well. So those were part of the decision-making process, yes.
And I suppose, given the projected expected increase in unemployment, the loss of the flexible workplace development fund for upskilling workers, that seems counterintuitive, given also what we're hearing across different sectors about the need for skills training, the need for upskilling. Where do you see that those gaps being plugged in the decisions that you've made?
So the first thing to say is that in Scotland we have near record low levels of unemployment, sitting at 3.8% compared to 4.2% for the rest of the UK. Again, I'm not complacent about that, and it brings with it its own challenges for employers, including on skills and access to labour. And so it is important that we continue to take an assessment of the skills landscape, which is what Graham Day is currently doing in response to the Withers Review, in order to ensure that we have a skills system that is as responsive as possible to the needs of employers, but also the needs of those that are either looking to enter the employment market for the first time or are looking to transition within the labour market and move on, such as in the energy sector. And that is an area that we will continue to focus in on, and Graham Day is obviously very exercised and is going round employer networks and others to ensure, as well as the skills sector, to ensure that our response to Withers is as informed as possible and that we are coming forward with a landscape that is going to be as supportive as possible, both for those that are seeking to get access to skilled employees, but also those that are looking to retrain.
Okay, and I suppose linked to that, the Flexible Workforce Development Fund drew on the apprenticeship levies that we got. If they aren't being used for that, where are those levies being directed to support employability?
In the employability sense, this is obviously going to be a shared responsibility between myself and Mr. Day. The investments that we're making, both in the college, the university sector, our school sector, the increase I think it was a 158 million in further higher education that came through this budget. I'll need to get that checked. We're continuing to invest in the skill system to ensure that we are meeting the needs both of those that are needing to get on and work, but also those that are looking to get access to the labour market.
I might come back in later on, but I'll leave it there now. Thanks.
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just following on from Maggie Chapman, first of all, in terms of employability and recognising the severe pressures that are on the budget, I think there are things that can be done that do not require huge amounts of money. And let me give you an example. We have a huge pool of talent within our neurodiverse population, and yet so many folks with a neurodiversity find it very difficult to get into employment. We have seen over the years the difference that the Carer Positive employer scheme has made in getting carers into employment. Would the Cabinet Secretary and his colleagues consider looking at seeing if a neurodiverse positive employer scheme could be established to try and get folk into the workforce, in a workforce I think that would be better for having them?
I thank Kevin Stewart for that question, which comes from quite a bit of experience in this sector that Mr. Stewart has, and he will be aware, having started this process, of the work that's been done in government to advance the rights, but also the advocacy that is available for people with neurodivergent conditions through the new champion that's coming through and other areas. And I think he makes a very sensible suggestion and one that I'd be more than happy to consider. I see from my own constituency casework the challenges that there are for families with children with neurodivergence. But also as they grow older, as Mr. Stewart points out, getting access to the employment market when, in many cases, majority of cases, they have a substantial amount to offer with very minor adjustments to the workplace. And I think this is where ensuring the best kept secret in Whitehall, the access to work scheme, is better promoted, but also other elements of Scottish Government support is also tailored to ensuring that we're taking fuller advantage of the economic potential that better support and access to work for people with neurodivergence can have.
Thank you. Thanks for that positive response. I'm going to change tack a little bit, Convener. Obviously, a priority for myself as a North East MSP is ensuring that just transition. And I certainly welcome the Government's commitment to the North East Just Transition Fund. I wish the UK Government would act in a similar manner and match the monies that the Scottish Government has allocated for this. But one of the things which is missing from the budget, Cabinet Secretary, is the £80 million that was committed by the Scottish Government for the Scottish Cluster for Carbon Capture and Storage. And I recognise that we're still waiting on Track 2 decisions from the UK Government, but could you give us an indication of what will happen here, because there's no allocation? If there is a move from the UK Government, will the Scottish Government find the money that has been promised to ensure that Scottish Cluster goes ahead?
In short, Convener, yes, that commitment stands. It isn't a single year commitment. I fully expect through discussions with the cluster that that £80 million will be deployed in a strategic way that ensures best value and the best strategic advantage for the cluster going forward. But it is entirely dependent and predicated on, clearly, it has to be, because there can't be CCUS without in this state without the UK government decision. It's entirely predicated on Track 2 making progress. And that, on that, we would encourage the UK government to move much faster to ensure that the opportunity that has been lost over the last decade or more of promises lost, opportunities gone, that we finally make up for that and see the Scottish cluster advancing. We need it in Scotland for our own net zero ambitions, for our industrial decarbonisation of the Scottish cluster, but so does the UK. This is entirely mutually beneficial and an investment that we need to see coming forward as soon as possible, and our £80 million commitment continues to stand.
Thank you. In terms of moving forward to net zero, in order to achieve that just transition, we're going to have to invest in innovation. And I've heard you and other members of the government say that we're going to have to be much more focused in terms of investment. We've seen, unfortunately, those budget decisions have had to be taken around about reducing enterprise agency money. But looking at everything in the round with enterprise agency investment, with just transition fund investment, how do we ensure that we are actually allocating the resource to the right companies, to the right entrepreneurs, to ensure that we reach our goal of net zero and that just transition? And I'll give you an example. I met the other week with a very smart tech company in my constituency, Zephyrus Aerolabs. Sometimes these companies have got difficulty in getting seed funding for that initial spurt of growth. How are we going to ensure that the enterprise agencies and the other monies that are allocated are going to the right places to create that spark to get what we all want to see, that growing green economy?
I thank Mr Stewart for that and for highlighting the very good work of the business in his constituency. There are a number of things that I would say. First of all, I was in the North East, in Aberdeen, for the launch with the First Minister of Scottish Enterprises' new corporate plan, which is focused on three key priorities, one of which is inspiring innovation. And so their investment decisions are filtered through those lenses, and one is around inspiring continued innovation. We are looking at and continue to expand, actually, through this budget, the likes of the Tech Scaler Network, which is about new business startups. It's about supporting and providing the ecosystem to ensure that those businesses are able to establish. And we're also continue to support the likes of SNIB and others who provide some of the early stage investment. But there are other opportunities, other areas that I'm happy to follow up in writing on regarding early stage investment opportunities that there are here in Scotland. The last thing that I'd say, particularly in the energy space, is we're cognizant of the fact that we need to plot a path. We need to set a direction of travel in terms of what it is that we are looking to focus our public sector funding on, not just for the new renewable energy supply chain that we're looking to see established, the offshore wind supply chain established here in Scotland, but also what catalytic impact those investments can have to leverage private investment. That's why the Green Industrial Strategy this year that we'll be publishing before the summer is going to be so important. It's going to be taking decisions. It's going to be saying that we are going to be prioritising certain sectors. In some cases, that's going to mean that some people aren't happy. But we're going to be taking that on the basis of the evidence that we have received from our engagement and the support that we've received from the likes of the First Minister's investor panel. At the back of all this, however, Mr Stewart will understand that when we are talking about innovation, when we're talking about early stage investment support, there is a risk attached to that. And we have to accept that there is going to be an element of risk. Some of these innovations will flourish, the businesses will do incredibly well, and we want to see that in Scotland. Others, in some cases, will not do as well. But I want to make sure that we have an ecosystem that is supportive of new innovation, that is supportive of new businesses establishing, and of attracting further capital and private sector investment as well. We're already seeing early stages of that good work coming through, but I want to see more coming forward.
Question, Convener, and it fits in well with your answer there around about the Green Industrial Strategy and our investment proposals coming from that, because obviously we know that in certain sectors there is huge potential. Hydrogen, we have huge potential, and particularly for export. We know that the German economy will require substantial amounts of hydrogen, and we have the ability to produce that here in Scotland. Obviously, we have to get that to Germany, but I know that other colleagues, including Mr. Beattie, and I have had conversations with folk who are very excited about our potential and what can be done here. And I think that, you know, it would not be difficult to get private investment for a number of these projects if the seed corn money was there initially. I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would make comment on that and whether we will peruse and pick some of these projects to ensure that we get that private sector investment that's required to move some of these things forward.
I think Mr Stewart's right. He tempts me to preempt what will be in the Green Industrial Strategy. But we're already investing in the likes of the Net Zero Technology Centre in Aberdeen, which is bringing together interested private sector parties on demonstrating the business case for a fixed link of a hydrogen pipeline between not just Scotland but other neighbouring countries and Germany, because he's right. And I was in Germany last year at the day of the signing of the UK-Germany hydrogen accord, and there is massive interest in industrial decarbonisation in Germany based upon green hydrogen, and they're wanting, for obvious geopolitical reasons, to diversify where they're getting their energy from, and we feel that we have an opportunity there with the abundance of renewable energy before us at the moment, but also going forward, to see some of that offtake to not necessarily go to the grid, but to go into other elements such as the production of green hydrogen. I think there are huge opportunities for us here to use hydrogen domestically for industrial decarbonisation, but also for export. And I think this will be an element that will be looking at as part of the Green Industrial Strategy process, and continue to work with industry. It's already happening, as I say, through the Net Zero Technology Centre and others, around the feasibility of how we get to that point.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I have been generous with members' time so far, but if you want to get through the business this morning, if I ask people to be as concise as possible, if the Cabinet Secretary could maybe consider his answers a bit shorter, that would be helpful. Colin Beattie to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to talk a little bit about enterprise agencies and their budgets. There have been significant reductions in the budgets for the enterprise agencies. Scottish Enterprise, nearly 17% in real terms. Highlands and Islands Enterprise, 14%. South of Scotland, nearly 22%. How will these reductions affect the support which is going to be available to businesses in Scotland in 24-25, and what types of activities will be prioritised and which will be deprioritised?
I appreciate the question from Colin Beattie. We've had to take very difficult decisions because of the fiscal context that we are operating within. I think it's widely appreciated by most reasonable commentators that this was one of the most challenging budgets in the devolution era. Rampant inflation, constrained public sector investment from the UK government has passed on a very, very challenging budget situation. So for all of our public bodies, we have been looking to ensure they're as efficient as possible. There has been an ask to achieve savings almost universally across the board, and our enterprise agencies are not immune from that. I can point, but obviously I'm working with all three in terms of how we ensure a very challenging budget situation can be navigated and ensure that we can see the economic activity and transformation that they help and support us achieve. That can be achieved. I'd point Mr. Beattie, as I did to Mr. Stewart, to the launch of the Scottish Enterprises new corporate plan, which provides a refocusing of their activities on the energy transformation that we are required to see, on ensuring that there is increased capital investment to ensure that there is greater productivity of our business community, and also on innovation, on seeing our businesses continue to innovate. Those are the areas that I would expect to see continued investment coming forward from our enterprise agencies.
So the enterprise agencies themselves are going to decide what the priority is for their area of responsibility?
In collaboration with myself and officials, yes.
Are there any guidelines they're working under?
No, not particularly. I think, as I say, I point to the work that's been done by Scottish Enterprise on the priorities that they are taking forward, making sure that we're taking greatest advantage of the greatest economic opportunity that we have before us, which is our energy transition, the just transition. That is obviously a climate imperative. And we need to make sure that we are tackling climate change. We've got clear responsibilities there, but it's also the greatest economic opportunity that we have as well. And we know that from the recommendations that have come through from the investor panel, which point to the fact that ScotWind is the greatest opportunity for us to leverage private capital. But to provide greater detail, I'm happy to bring in Colin Cook.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I just thought it might be worth explaining the process. One of my roles is as the sponsor directorate of our enterprise agencies and Visit Scotland. And that gives me a role of setting out ministerial priorities, and they're defined in the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And we set those out on an annual basis and an ongoing basis to make sure that the agencies are working to the core government economic strategy. Responsible, therefore, following that for performance management, for assessing the way in which the agencies are operating. And I believe I'm responsible for working with them and supporting our agencies to make the adjustments and to make the impact that we believe they can have. All four of those agencies I've referenced are looking very, very closely at what the budget settlement means to them. They've got a clear set of shared objectives, which they share with the Scottish Government. And I've been very encouraged by the way in which the leadership of those organisations is responding.
Are there job losses anticipated?
I haven't had that communicated to me, no.
Within the enterprise agencies? I mean, obviously, the enterprise agencies and Visit Scotland are looking at the overall budget that they've been given, and in line with other public sector agencies, they're looking at whether the numbers of people they employ is part of that solution. So they are considering all options in order to make sure that they're as efficient as possible.
If they're doing less, then they need less resources to do that.
I don't think it would be fair to say that they're doing less. They're prioritising the funding that they have on areas that are going to maximise the economic opportunities before them. So as Colin Cook has set out, their ability to invest the money that they have available to them is going to be balanced with the numbers of in the workforce that is going to be available to them, and whether or not the numbers that they have at present are going to be conducive to them spending against that. So these are going to be balances and decisions that are going to be taken by the enterprise agencies. And as Mr. Cook has set out, we'll continue to work with them to ensure that they are doing that in an efficient way as possible, but also recognising the NSET priorities.
Just an extension of that, the decrease in the resource budget for the enterprise agencies and other national bodies is partly driven by the wider public sector efficiency programme. Can you set out more detail on the progress made so far within your portfolio and what impact these deficiencies are expected to have on delivery and the final outcome he expects from the efficiency programme?
Thank you. So rather than it being, obviously efficiencies are going to be important to public sector reform, but we're looking at public sector reform not just purely on reductions in spending. So that is a process that's been led by the Deputy First Minister. We are embarked on a process of ensuring that our business support landscape is as efficient as possible. That includes looking at the work that's done by Business Gateway, but done by our enterprise agencies, the role that our regional economic partnerships play within that to ensure that we've got a clear business support landscape that responds to the needs of business, that people understand, depending on what part of their journey they're on, depending on what location they're in, what sector they're in, they understand what door to turn to in order to receive the support that they need. And I've had early discussions with COSLA, because they have a responsibility clearly for Business Gateway, and other parties on ensuring that we have a public sector reform piece coming forward that meets those ambitions, and the direction of travel that we have given to our enterprise agencies is, again, I point back to the corporate plan that has been published by Scottish Enterprise that is ensuring that they are focused in on the key areas of priority, and making sure that those are aligned to our priorities for the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which, as I outlined in my opening remarks, we're also currently undergoing a refresh of to ensure that we're focused on prioritising those actions across that 10-year plan.
My final question is really about a bit of a clarification. The Level 4 spreadsheet, which accompanies the Scottish Budget, notes that the overall capital budget for the enterprise agencies is, and I quote, maintained in line with existing spending review capital plans, unquote. In real terms, the capital budgets of the three enterprise agencies reduced by 4.6% in 24-25, or 24.6% if financial transactions are included. What is going to be the impact of that?
It's undeniable that the reduction in the capital allocation that the Scottish Government has received and is receiving going forward, there's a projected 10% cut to our capital budget over the coming 5 years, will have an impact, particularly when that's set against rising inflation and supply chain pressures. Financial transactions budget, we have allocated almost all of the financial transaction budget to Scottish National Investment Bank, and that reduction is directly attributable to the reduction in the financial transactions taken by the UK government. So in both of these areas, you can see a direct correlation between UK government decisions and the impact that they are having on our budget and the decision making possibilities that we have available to us. It's undeniable that will have an impact. In the energy space, in the enterprise agency space, I would far rather see an increase in capital expenditure, particularly given the opportunities that we have before us with the energy transition. However, the potential for us to be able to do that at a time when our capital budget has been squeezed so hard by the UK government is more than challenging.
Thank you, Colin Smith, be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Convener. Can I just follow on from those questions? I mean, we know this is a challenging budget, but we've heard the overall budget is up, the department budget is down by 8%, but the cuts to the enterprise agencies are 3-4 times higher than that overall cut in the budget, and particularly South of Scotland Enterprise, which sees a cut of 22%. I mean, given that we have huge economic inequalities across Scotland. So, for example, South of Scotland has the lowest wages, the highest level of outward migration of young people because of the lack of high-paid, high-skilled jobs. What does this budget say about tackling those economic inequalities in those areas when you're cutting peripheral areas, enterprise budgets, by so much?
Well, of course, we established the South of Scotland enterprise because we recognised the fact that only a few years ago, because we recognised the fact that we wanted to take greater advantage of the economic potential of the South of Scotland. And I'm very pleased at the work that Russell Griggs and his team have done to do exactly that. And on an area that Mr. Smith talks about, they've been very well engaged on supporting the Real Living Wage campaign that there is in the South of Scotland and are seeing great results off the back of that, which I would continue to support them to do. Look, I more than appreciate the challenge that there is for our enterprise agencies, as there will be for others across across Scotland as a result of this budget. There are major opportunities available, however. There are big economic opportunities coming through, not just from the energy transition, but from the innovation, the digital sector, the investment we're making in increasing the digital budget is going to have a disproportionate impact on rural communities and is going to see broadband rolled out through the R100 programme, making up for the shortfall in funding that has come for what is a reserved area. So we'll continue to do what we can to invest, recognise not just the challenges but also the economic opportunities that there are in more rural areas, including in the South of Scotland, and I'll continue to work with Russell Griggs and his team, for whom I have a very good working relationship, to ensure that the opportunities and that they are working towards can be met.
We see those opportunities because the Minister knows we've got the highest number of wind farms, for example, in Scotland, the South of Scotland, but very few of those renewable jobs so far. So I hope we see that change. But as well as cuts in the enterprise agency, the Scottish National Investment Bank also sees its budget cut by a third. to the lowest level since it began to operate, despite the fact the chair of the bank says that the planned £2 billion public capitalisation is not going to be sufficient to meet the bank's mission. So why is that cut so large? And are the Scottish Government still on track to provide that £2 billion committed to SNB? I mean, do you still expect, for example, the bank to be self-financing by 2025?
I hope so, and on both counts. And there can be, as I'd said in response to Mr. Beattie, there can be a direct correlation on financial transactions, for instance, between the cut that the UK government has taken and the ability that we have to be able to allocate. We've allocated almost all of the financial transactions available to us to the Scottish National Investment Bank, but obviously they are also hugely reliant upon capital funding, and our capital budget is going down by 10% over the next 5 years. So, you know, decisions at a UK level have direct consequences for our decision-making opportunities here in Scotland. I would far rather we saw those problems cut off at source and we see an investment coming from the UK government. I don't see that coming either from this Tory UK government or indeed from an incoming Labour government, sadly. And if we can't have that, then that makes the argument for Scottish independence all the greater.
I think we will see more investment. And certainly what we will see from the UK Labour government is growth, which we haven't seen in the Scottish government. However, sticking to the issue around financial transactions that you mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, I mean, what progress do you expect on SNB being able to access capital beyond the existing capital beyond those financial transactions? One of the issues that was raised at this committee by the chair was securing the regulatory permissions necessary to manage third-party capital. I mean, what progress do you see taking place in the forthcoming year to enable them to be able to do that and access other forms of funding?
Firstly, in response to Mr. Smith's point around growth, of course, we've seen 10% per capita growth in Scotland's economy since 2007 compared to 6% in the rest of the UK. So his assertion that we don't see growth in Scotland is sadly wrong. But in terms of the... And I continue to support economic growth for a purpose, which is to invest in a wellbeing economy. However, the point that Mr. Smith made around SNB, we continue to discuss asks of the chair and the chief executive around financial flexibilities as they continue to grow and develop. And we have given a commitment to them in a meeting only, I think it was 2 weeks ago, to explore just that this year. So those discussions are ongoing and we're looking at what we can do to ensure that they are able to operate in the way that Mr. Smith has outlined, both in those asks but in others as well.
I
can't put a timescale on that, but those discussions are ongoing.
Something else you're not being able to put a timescale on so far is the fact that 4 years after the legislation was passed to establish the bank, you haven't yet established the advisory board to oversee its work. I mean, do you have an update on what the timescale for that would be?
I think it's entirely fair that an advisory board that is going to be looking at the performance of the bank needs to wait for the bank to be established before it can be functionable. But the work is ongoing in order to establish the advisory board that will provide that additional assurance measures beyond that are already in place for a non-departmental public body and for a PLC to ensure that we have confidence, as I do, have no reason not to, in the decisions and the performance of the bank. That process is ongoing.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald will be followed by Brian Buttle.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned earlier in your opening remarks that digital connectivity had increased by 50%. And, you know, looking at the numbers, it is indeed up from 93 million to 140 million. What do you expect to achieve from that increased budget on the forthcoming financial year?
So that is to ensure that we continue to roll out broadband capability that's part of the R100 programme. It's about providing that infrastructure to ensure that we are able to match the digitisation and innovation aspirations of our business community. And as I said in response to Mr Smith, that is going to be, by its nature, disproportionately beneficial to rural and island communities where this rollout is going to be needed the most. And I look forward to continued expansion of the R100 programme coming forward in this financial year off the back of this 50% increase. It's also a good investment, in the supply chain and the business opportunities that are going to be available for our companies across Scotland as well.
Yeah. I mean, you touched upon the R100 programme and how important it is, but as you mentioned earlier, broadband is reserved to the Westminster government. So why did you feel it was necessary for you to increase the budget in this area? And are we on target to complete the R100 programme by 2028 still?
Yes, and the need for us to have an R100 programme at all, as Mr. McDonald rightly references, for an area that is a reserve competence, is because there has been an underinvestment there by the UK government, that we're not going to see the digital rollout happen as quickly as we need it to for our rural businesses in particular. So we're making an increased commitment to see the target being met, and to ensure that the economic growth opportunity that comes off the back of that is available to as many people as possible, not just businesses, but also domestic households that will have access to this as well.
The other issue I wanted to ask you about the R100 was the fact that Scotland has over 90 inhabited islands, and I understand that Fair Isle was connected to full fibre 2 years ahead of schedule, and it used world-leading technology to boost the signal. Can you provide us an update on where the rollout of R100 is in relation to the islands?
As somebody originally from Orkney and having visited Orkney in the Christmas recess, I can confirm that the connectivity, particularly on mobile data, is much improved, and Mr. McDonald is correct regards the connectivity for Fair Isle, and I'll be happy to provide a further update to the committee with more detail on the work that we've got proposed coming forward on the expansion of R100 to our island communities that would satisfy his inquiries.
Okay, and my final point is in relation to the final contracts for R100 that were signed fairly recently, but it was prior to the price inflation we've seen in construction costs. Is there going to be any impact on the Scottish Government's budget of the fact that there has been, increased construction costs recently in the economy? Is that something that the contract allows additional charges for, or is that something to be borne by the supplier?
Given Mr. McDonald's background, he'll understand the fact that supply chain price inflation has an impact on our spending power and our ability to be able to deliver as much with the budget that we have available to us. However, we are working with our suppliers and doing what we can to ensure that is mitigated as far as possible. It's not always going to be possible, and in some cases we're going to be having to spend more in order to get less. That is the nature of inflation. But again, as part of that response that I give to the committee regarding the progress of R100, I'll set out more in terms of his inquiry there.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Brian Whittle will be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Kavira. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary will be aware of my interest in sort of longer-term strategies and preventable agenda, etc. And following on from some of the questioning earlier on, I want to just dig in a little bit to the cuts to enterprise agencies and SNB and no allocation of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. That will inevitably lead to less investment. It will lead to less support to establish companies, to grow companies, which long-term will lead to less of a tax take, with less money in the future budget. Where's the long-term economic strategy in the current budget?
That comes from our national strategy for economic transformation that sets out our long-term economic aspirations. There's also the Green Industrial Strategy coming forward, the Innovation Strategy that is available and was published last year. There are various plans and strategies that we have available to us. But Mr. Whittle must understand, assuming that he, like Mr. Fraser, continues to support UK government spending plans, that they have an impact. And that impact, especially if we hadn't taken the tax decisions that we took, has an impact on our ability to spend in these areas. So we are allocating our resource as best we can to ensure we're maximising the economic opportunities before us. But UK spending decisions have an impact. They have, in reality, for us, a direct consequence. And that has meant some very difficult spending decisions. But if we'd replicated UK spending plans, we would have seen a real terms cut to our NHS, which at this time, and given Mr. Whittle's interests in a healthier nation, would just not be, could not be comprehended. And so while it is admittedly a difficult spending decision for some of the reasons that he highlights, we're working with our enterprise agencies, with SNB and others, to ensure that we're getting the maximum from that investment possible and that we're taking advantage of the maximum opportunities available to us.
I think the Cabinet Secretary misses the fact that decisions made at Scottish level have consequences. And what I'm trying to get to here is that if you invest less in business, you'll have less money to invest in the public services. In fact, if you invest less in those areas, you'll require more investment in public services. I'm looking at, and you're talking about a long-term strategy, and you've talked very well today about government targets, but by cutting these particular agencies, you're actually giving yourself less opportunity to create that wealth that we that will generate enough tax take to input into public services. So again, I ask you, where's the long-term strategy in this budget?
The National Strategy for Economic Transformation is a 10-year strategy, economic strategy, for us to transform our economy, to take advantage of the opportunities that we have available to us. I believe that you need a good economy and a good society. You need the two are mutually reliant. You cannot have a good economy without a good society, and so investment in public services is absolutely essential. And we will do everything that we can to ensure that the money that has been prioritised for business, such as £685 million worth of business rates relief, the maintenance of the small business bonus scheme, which is taking an estimated 100,000 business properties out of rates relief altogether, is the most generous in the UK. 95% of businesses are paying less in non-domestic rates than elsewhere in the UK. We are looking to ensure that the decisions that we have taken in this budget are balanced and continue to see economic activity and economic growth opportunities coming through, but balanced against the need to ensure that we protect public services so that we have a healthy workforce that is supporting a growing economy.
Reality on the ground is that the decisions that the Scottish Government have made have got a further education sector that's screaming for more investment, and you have a university sector that now has to cut 1,200 places to Scottish students. On the back of the Withers review as well, how on earth does that help our Scottish economy? Surely that's a false economy. If we are not creating and giving opportunity equally to our Scottish students, how on earth do we continue to support a well-being economy?
I recognise the fact that we need to make sure that our skills landscape is supportive of, as I'd said in previous remarks to Maggie Chapman and to Kevin Stewart, that we need a good skills landscape to ensure we are providing the labour market that allows businesses to grow, but also allows people to get on, to take advantage of the just transition that we are seeing in the energy sector, for instance. The figure that Mr Whittle points to on higher education places was, of course, a temporary investment off the back of COVID. So the figures that we have now are returning to pre-COVID levels. But, of course, we'll continue to work with our university sector. Indeed, I've got a meeting with them next week to discuss how we can take full advantage of the innovation that is going on within our university sector, the investment that we're making on entrepreneurial campuses. I was able to see incredible work at Strathclyde University last week on the entrepreneurial support that they are providing their students and what the benefit that that's providing, not just to new business startups, but also to the income that is income potential that they are able to achieve, and the work that is going on a collaborative basis with our universities to see that level of investment grow. So we've got big opportunities. I recognise some of the challenges that there are, but we'll continue to work with our skills colleagues. Mr Day, as I say, is incredibly energised in making sure that our response to Withers does have that supportive skills landscape going forward, and we'll make sure that the resource that we put behind it is as much as we possibly can to ensure that we have a landscape that is supportive as possible, not just for our employers, but also for our workforce.
If I could take this in a sort of similar route and bring in the third sector here, the choice has been made by the government, and the squeeze on the council budget is making us giving our councils almost impossible decisions to make. And for example, even in my own area, I know of, I'm speaking to two mental health third sector organisations that are now no longer funded and will have to shut. This, of course, means that those people that they support will still have to get treatment, and what they will do is just join a queue, an NHS queue. So it might come out of the ledger in the Scottish Council, the council budget, but it will still come out of the budget and for the Scottish Government in another portfolio. Do you not recognise that this is a false economy? Those kind of cuts are a false economy. And again, I say to you, it's a short-term gain for long-term pain, and there's no real inter-portfolio working here, cross-portfolio working here to tackle that kind of issue.
So we have increased funding for local government. That is recognised in the budget. I recognise, though, that all elements of the public sector are facing fiscal challenges, and that is born of the decisions that are taken at UK level. The challenge that has been faced by local government in England, where we've got local authorities going bankrupt, is self-evident, and the cuts that are happening to local authorities in England are of a far greater scale. We're not willing to follow that. That's why we've taken the tax decisions that we have in order to prioritise public spending. So my encouragement, if Mr Whittle understands the consequence of UK spending decisions happening on Scottish Government spending decisions happening on local government spending decisions, as he's just pointed out, then I would far rather we worked together to see the initial damage being done to our financial public sector financial landscape by UK government spending decisions, because whether it's on mental health or social work or education, ensuring that we have preventative spending going in at an early stage, that is exactly why we've prioritised ensuring that we are protecting as far as we possibly can our public sector budgets.
I think the councils would disagree with your analogy there, but I also say that the decisions that Scottish Government have made continue to make Scotland the unhealthiest nation in Europe. They continue to see a huge reduction in our PISA scores, and that is the reality on the ground. I want to see a budget, and I'm going to ask the Cabinet Secretary, when is the budget going to address those kind of elements there, which are actually a huge strain on our economy?
So we are making substantial investments in education and in health. Both of those areas of the budget are up. The public, the local government settlement is up, the NHS is also up, because I recognise the assessment that Mr Whittle has made, that we need to make sure we have a healthy workforce, that we're investing in areas to ensure that we do that. But you know, areas such as ensuring we have minimum unit pricing, that we tackle the unhealthy products that are available, are just some of the areas that we need to come forward with. So I look forward to working with Mr Whittle on those areas to ensure that those areas are got right, and where we have agreement that we can take those forward as quickly as possible, even if those predominantly sit out with my portfolio responsibilities.
Right, outcomes are all that's matter. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I completely understand the challenging fiscal context for the budget and the backdrop of austerity. I note the reduction in Visit Scotland's budget. Cabinet Secretary, can you tell us what the impact of this is going to be, and are Visit Scotland going to do things differently?
So we're working very closely with Visit Scotland to ensure that we maximise what is an incredibly important aspect of our economy. The tourism sector contributes a substantial amount to our economy. We're seeing international visitors up, international spending up, and not just on this year, but on pre-COVID as well, which is incredibly encouraging that people wish to come and visit Scotland and are spending their money here, which is important for our economy. So we'll work with Visit Scotland on the implications of the budget on what they are able to provide as a service to ensure that we continue to have Scotland as a not just an international but a domestic destination of choice.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. In the interest of time, Convener, I'll leave it there.
Thank you, Ms Tweed. Could I maybe just pick up on something that the committee have written to the government about before, which is the small business bonus scheme. And the government did commission a report from Fraser of Allender to look at the scheme. And there were changes introduced in April last year. Because one of the factors that they raised was, while the scheme was valued, it did risk restraining economic growth, because businesses tended to group just below where the cut-off points were before, so it maybe held back businesses making a decision to expand their business or, you know, expand their premises, because they would lose the scheme. And the government did commission the work but didn't really kind of respond, I didn't think, to Fraser of Allender's report in a significant way. Have the changes in April made any differences to some of the issues that Fraser of Allender raised around the scheme?
The Fraser of Allender assessments have been very helpful in demonstrating some of the positive elements of the small business bonus scheme, in ensuring that some businesses continue to be viable, and other elements of more challenge that that you point out, Convener. I think it's fair to say that across government, Tom Arthur, as part of the New Deal for Business group, is looking at what we can do to bring forward longer-term non-domestic rates reform. Some of that work is challenging, because where we make a change, there will be winners and losers, and there's a potential cost either to be borne by government or indeed by the business sector. So we're looking at taking forward a long-term evidence-based approach to non-domestic rates reform. Part of that discussion was had with the hospitality industry last week about what areas might be helpful for them, what barriers to growth there may be through the current setup, and looking at whether or not there are ways of bringing forward reform that don't have a wider unintended consequence. And you know, part of that assessment is going to be informed by the work that has been done by the Fraser of Allender Institute.
Thank you. In your opening statement, you referred to the Anna Stewart report. So the government did have a previous commitment of £50 million for a women's business centre. In this budget, you have set out that following the Anna Stewart review, a different approach will be taken in how we support women entrepreneurs. Where in the budget, I mean, I think it's what you said, that it's, I can't find the actual quote. You said this is work that has been taken forward. Stated the 24-25 budget provides the resources necessary to make early progress on delivery. Where is that money? Where can we see that investment has been put in the budget?
So I'll find out exactly where the budget line is, but it's £1.5 million that we're starting with an investment on the implementation of. I'll take Aidan Griswood in shortly to point you in the exact place where this has been held. As I set out in the letter to you, convener, and to the committee, I think it was on the 19th of December, Anna Stewart's review, a pathways review alongside Mark Logan, considered a dedicated women's business centre, consulted widely upon it, and concluded that that was not necessarily the best way of encouraging female participation in business. Now, there's going to be differing opinions upon that, but based on that quite wide range in consultation and feedback, we've decided to accept Anna Stewart's recommendations that the likes of pre-start centres and pop-up centres are going to be the most advantageous way of progressing a greater diversity in business startups and encouraging more women to get into business. And that's where the £1.5 million this year is going to start looking at expanding. And I'll happily bring in Aidan to provide greater detail upon that.
Yeah, because it was a £50 million commitment. So is the £1.5 in this year, is that anticipated to increase in future years? That would take us almost 20 years if we're going to go at the rate of £1.5 over £50 million. Is the £50 million commitment still
for
a business centre?
Yes. Yeah, so it was a different commitment. That was for a women's business centre. As I say, the consultation and engagement that Anna Stewart and Mark Logan were engaged in, that was not going to be the most effective way of getting women into business.
So now there's 1.5 in this financial
to begin with.
But it's anticipated that will increase in future years? Or?
Yes, obviously I can't account for future budgets but as yet because we don't have sight for that. But yes, I would hope that we'd be able to continue to invest greater levels in this space because I recognise, the government recognises that having greater diversity in business startups is a untapped economic opportunity and ensuring that we are releasing the full potential of women in this case but other groups as well. To get into business, to get on in the employment market is an area that we see as being a good opportunity for business growth and is also the right thing to do. And I'll happily take Aidan in on the particular budget area of where it lands.
Yeah, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. That's a very simple ask. It's in the innovation and industries line within the budget that also includes the increase in the tech scale of funding to £9.5 million a year ahead.
Okay. And how are we going to monitor the impact of that 1.5 so that we know that it is making a difference? And how is the government going to measure the effectiveness of that investment in terms of encouraging women into business? Or?
As with all government investments, there must be an appraisal of its efficacy. And as we set out our plans for that investment this year of £1.5 million, working with Anna Stewart and Mark Logan on how that will work, so we will set out how we will monitor and evaluate its progress.
And will it be shared with the committee in terms of how, I suppose, you've given me a rough idea of how the 1.5 is going to be spent, but also we might have questions over the geographical spend of that or, you know, those. Will we get a more detailed picture of how that money is something the committee's had an interest in? Will we get a more detailed picture of how that money will be invested?
Absolutely, I'm happy to give that commitment. We're still in discussions with Anna Stewart and Mark Logan as to the budget allocation that we have for the coming year and how it's best invested to begin with. Once we have further information, I'd be more than happy to share that with the committee to ensure that you're fully appraised of the decisions that are taken.
Okay, thank you. That now brings us to the end of the session. Cabinet Secretary and his officials for attending this morning. I now move into private session.